if you look on a very fine scale at light, on the scale at which you can see how the light is vibrating differently at different places, that's phase, then you find there are certain places where the phase isn't defined. If you would ask, how is the light vibrating at such a place, it's like asking, what's the time at the North Pole? You know, it's a question, you don't have an answer because all the timelines meet. Well, these are lines in space where this happens. And in recent years, they've been studied a great deal. For a long time after we wrote about them, people didn't take much notice. But then, actually, with the fall of the Soviet Union, which left a lot of experimental groups with essentially no money and wondering what to do, and realizing that experiments in this area are not very expensive, there became this explosion of research, and now it's what we're discussing at this meeting, on the nature of these lines and so on. So in the first talk, I spoke about how the energy is flowing near these lines. And the way it flows is it flows around. That's why these things are sometimes called optical vortices. It's another term for the same thing. Phase singularities, nodal lines, the intensity is zero there, but around you get this interesting geometrical structure. And so the first lecture was clarifying the concept of current, optical currents, which is different if you're considering light where you don't think about the polarization structure, the vector nature, and light where you do. And I clarified the different types of current associated with the spin, current associated with orbital motion, and so on. So that was the first talk. And the second talk was about a rather surprising application of this singular optics to these devices that are used throughout optics, namely interferometers. And pointing out, and it's still an abstract conceptual thing, I mean, it must be true, but I don't know if it has any application, but the fact that every interferometer where you separate waves and then you bring them back together again and look at the interference, every interferometer must have threading through it some of these special lines of phase singularity. And the way the lines thread through is related to what you're using the interferometer to measure. So there are these hidden lines which every now and then pass across one of the arms of the interferometer in ways that I described and you can calculate. And this has various connections. In particular, although I talk about it in light, it also has applications in quantum physics, and I briefly mentioned those. So that's what I spoke about in these two talks. I have a senior colleague, John Nye. He's not a young man, he's now 87. Before he worked on optics, he was a glaciologist, and he was studying the ice around the world, in particular the ice that covers Antarctica. Now, this ice is several kilometers thick and covers 10% of the Earth's surface. And he came to me in the early 1970s to discuss recent experiments where radio waves penetrated the ice and were reflected from the bottom, enabling the first maps of this large land area to be created. But he pointed out that such mapping only uses the first return of the echo. When the echo comes back, you know the time it takes, and so you know the depth. But also, there's a long disorderly tail of reflections from more distant places off to the side, which tells you something about the roughness of the surface of Antarctica. And he consulted me about the theoretical interpretation of that. Now, as part of that work, he had an undergraduate project, a student project, where instead of these radio waves, which have 5 meter length, he had ultrasound of a millimeter length. Instead of Antarctica's bottom, he had crinkly kitchen foil. So it was an analog experiment in the lab where you could compactly look at every detail of the reflection that come back. And he noticed something there, which then we discussed together, some curious feature of the echo, which we didn't understand until we realized that what it was one of these lines of phase singularity passing through. And so then we worked together, John Nye and I, and we realized that this was a fundamental concept in wave physics much more generally, and that wrote about it, and that's how it began. So it began with in glaciology, with studies of Antarctica. As interpreted at this meeting, the phrase singular optics is not, doesn't represent the full structure of the field, because here it's interpreted just to describe these phase lines, these optical vortices, but it's actually much more general than that. And I indeed began studying these things before I understood phase singularities. And at a much coarser level, where you don't look at the fine structure of waves, but where you look at the rays of geometrical optics, which is an approximate description at an earlier level, then you also get geometrical structures and singularity in optics, namely focusing singularities. The rainbow is an example. The V-shaped wake behind a ship that moves, you can see here in the Adriatic as they move, is, you know, the patterns of light that dance on the bottom of swimming pools when the sunshine is refracted through the ripply surface. These are all examples of focusing. If you look in fine detail at these patterns of focusing, then you see in them structures which reflect the fact that really there are waves and the rays are just an approximation. You see fine scale interference structures. These live in the borderland between waves and rays. Okay. Now it turns out that whenever you go from one level of description in physics, say from an older description to a more rich, more recent description, it turns out that the relation between them is much more complicated than people think. And it's because there are phenomena that live in the borderlands. So, for example, in quantum physics, you want to understand the connection with classical physics. Now, one aspect of this connection is that for the very high excited states of molecules, the energy levels of molecules, very high excited levels, there are patterns in the arrangement which, again, a borderland phenomena, because they reflect whether the underlying old-fashioned classical motion is chaotic or not. So classical chaos shows itself, but in quantum physics, the deeper bit, in this borderland region when you're near to the classical world but not quite there. And phenomena like this surround physics. For example, in fluid mechanics, you've got this phenomenon of turbulence, this erratic motion. This emerges when the viscosity of the fluid is very small. The fluid is not very viscous. However, if you pretend the viscosity was exactly zero, you'd have a completely different kind of motion. So in the borderland between viscous fluid flow and slippery fluid flow, you get this very important phenomenon, still not properly understood, that fluid flows erratically, this turbulence. So throughout physics, there are these borderland phenomena, which I'm drawing attention to in that statement that you quoted from me.